All right, so my name is Alex, and I'm a director of engineering at Autodesk. And the reason why I'm here is because I manage the deployment automation team at Autodesk, and we were an essential piece of delivering the FedRAMP strategy for Autodesk. The legal team reviewed my PowerPoint presentation, and they make sure that I can tell you that we are not currently FedRAMP authorized. We are very close. I have not received an email today. I may receive it tomorrow or the day after, or who knows, it's the government. But we've crossed all the T's and dotted all the I's for that. All right, so what am I gonna cover today? I'm gonna tell you who's Autodesk. You may not know who's Autodesk. I'll talk to you about why FedRAMP is important for us. We'll tell you about our strategy on how to get to FedRAMP, some of our lessons learned, and next steps after that. What I'm not gonna cover to you is what is FedRAMP in detail. I'm not gonna go through every one of the 300 and I don't even know 65 controls and all that. That is extremely well documented. You can find all of that on the web on how to get to those in detail. All right, so let's talk a little bit about who's Autodesk. Autodesk is a global leader in 3D design, engineering, and entertainment software. If you don't know Autodesk, you know what our customers do. The chairs you're sitting on, this building, the headset I'm wearing, they were probably all designed using Autodesk software. And our customers are, they're big, they're small, they're everywhere in the world. They're working on infrastructure projects, construction, mechanical, engineering, anything. They could be doing 3D printing out of their garages and selling them on Etsy, for all we know. And Autodesk itself is a global company where we have offices all around the world. My team alone is in 7 different countries. I have 14 states in the United States, and I have 7 different time zones. We're 24/7. We never stop. All right, so let's talk a little bit about why FedRAMP for us. Autodesk is known for desktop. You've probably heard of AutoCAD, of Revit, Maya, but we have over 100 products and services. A lot of those products and services are cloud. They're web, mobile, they're connected, or they're seamlessly connected to the desktop experience. So you start a project on the desktop and you move to the cloud and the customer doesn't even know that they're operating on the cloud. Now, if you're a customer that's operating and working for the U.S. government requires FedRAMP on the cloud. So that customer can ends up not being able to use our products and services. The U.S. government would also like to be a customer of ours, but they can't because we require FedRAMP. So that makes it very simple. In order to sell to those customers or to the U.S. government, we need to have a FedRAMP authorized cloud. Now, more importantly than just the U.S. government, some states are also starting with more complex regulation that requires similar to FedRAMP or FedRAMP-like compliance. Some countries are doing the same. Japan, Singapore, Australia have very strict regulations that are almost like FedRAMP. Some of them are actually carbon copies of FedRAMP regulations. So we have to be ready for those. In essence, it's a business decision. For us to do business, we need to have FedRAMP. All right, so let's talk a little bit about our strategy. All right, so when the business says we want FedRAMP, okay, great, we're gonna go do all this research, we figure out there's different levels of FedRAMP, low, MISES, moderate, high, etc. And it high goes into crazy la-la land complex. So we started asking the business, what do you need? What do the customers need? And we settled on FedRAMP moderate for our offerings. Something that was also interesting, we have a SOC 2 cloud, so it was, okay, let's do an evaluation. What is the gap between SOC 2 and FedRAMP? And we quickly realized that we couldn't get our commercial cloud and just say, hey, let's bring that up to FedRAMP. That doesn't work. It was not feasible for us. So we decided on, okay, we need another stack that is dedicated for the federal government. Okay, that's part one of that strategy. That's awesome. Once we've done that, we started to look at the boundary. What is, for anyone working on FedRAMP, the boundary tells you what is, what are all those services that are inside this, I call it a bubble, the FedRAMP bubble, and everything that's in there needs to be authorized and audited. So we started looking into that, and that started setting up a lot of that decision making for us. Now, taking a step back, and I'm talking here about a little bit of the how. Around the same time the business told us we want to do FedRAMP, we were working on, well, Europe wants a cloud for themselves. Australia wants a cloud for themselves. Everybody wants a cloud for themselves. So we started retooling ourselves with a deployment automation that allows us to do a little bit more flexible deployments. So this deployment automation that we built supported SOC 2 out of the box, supported all the security non-negotiables out of the box. So it was a lot easier for developers to work with. Everything is modern, open source, out of like really, really cutting edge infrastructure and configuration as code. You've heard that before, nothing rocket science here. And one of the things we built is that deploying to a new region was a lot easier. When we first went to Europe, it took us 6 months to a year to go to Europe. When we go to a new region now, it takes a month or less. Right, you just add a new configuration and boom, a new cloud is deployed. You may need to configure and do a few other tweaks, but that's pretty much it. And because everything is carbon copy deployed in a template, it's a lot easier for developers to manage and maintain. So a developer can maintain with little toil, 3, 4, 5, 10 stacks because they're all the same. We don't have 10 stacks. Good Lord, that would be crazy right now. We have US and EMEA and FedRAMP. All right, so essentially, when the business was coming to us and say, I want FedRAMP, it's a new stack, and we have the ability to deploy new stacks, guess what? We deployed FedRAMP as a new region. The US has 3 regions. We picked one that was different than the one we were in and said, that one's going to be our FedRAMP region. Cognitive load. I know if it's in UE2, it's FedRAMP. If it's in UE1, it's everything else. Now, of course, I can just deploy that. That was a SOC 2 cloud, not a FedRAMP cloud, right? So, okay, what are the gaps to do that? And that was our next analysis, right? We were already using GitOps for this new platform. So we built all the other necessary controls into the GitOps templates. We went through every one of our hardened infrastructure and reviewed it for FedRAMP compliance, and we made sure that if SSL is there, SSL is turned on. If you've heard about FedRAMP, you've heard about FIPS, and you probably have a PhD in FIPS because it's complicated. Guess what? Our developers don't care about FIPS. They don't even know FIPS exists because we built it into the platform. We put FIPS as a sidecar. We put FIPS in the configurations for them. We put FIPS in as an Nginx proxy in the box, and the developers don't even know that FIPS is there. They don't need to. We turned on FIPS for 60 services with a flip of a switch. So it was a lot easier for developers to operate and do that. All right. So let's talk a little bit about our lessons learned. So FedRAMP is a journey. It's taken us maybe 2 years to get here. Little less than 2 years because we've deployed our cloud. We went through our audit around 6 months ago. But it's a journey because we're not authorized. If we did an audit 6 months ago and we're not yet authorized, you can imagine it's a journey, right? But one of the big things we had to do was understand those dependencies, right? Because when we're multi-region, we have some services that are global and some services that are regionalized. In the FedRAMP bubble, everything is in there. So I had a whole slew of new services that I had to consider that So I needed to understand all those dependencies. I need to understand everything in the kitchen sink that goes inside the boundary, all the vendors, all the third parties, everything. We also had to do an analysis of the business needs. Right. So if you're familiar with AWS GovCloud, okay, you can use GovCloud and you have a lot more FedRAMP out of the box. That's great, but Autodesk is a global company. We have a you build it, you run it policy. I can't have an engineer in Singapore operating GovCloud. It's not, they're not US persons, so I cannot do that. So we had to settle for AWS commercial. That means I have to build some of that functionality into the platform that I would have gotten out of the box in GovCloud. All right, something else that was interesting is the platform value. I've talked a lot about it. So when we audited our platform, you audit one container deployment, you've audited them all. You've audited one piece of infrastructure, you've audited them all. They're literally carbon copies of each other. But it's more than just the infrastructure. We took it, we did also, the documentation was like that. So if we're gonna do architectural diagrams, you don't need to do, we built templates for them and people just filled out their service names, but the diagrams all work the same. All documentation, everything was a lot easier to clone and copy. When we did our internal audits, we found some things here and there that were missed. Guess what? We fix them in the platform. Everybody gets them. Oh, I don't like where your logs are going. We changed the logs. Great. We changed the logs once. Everybody gets them. So this multiplier value of a platform was really, really important for us to get here. And then the last thing is, like I said, we went AWS commercial. We didn't use GovCloud. So we had to look into what is available as moderate for every one of the AWS services. When we did that dependency tree, we had to look into everything. And we found some services were not FedRAMP authorized. Great, I can't use them. Right? We worked with AWS to understand roadmaps and stuff, but if they weren't supported, we had to change. That was enough runway for us to make some of those choices. Our solution architects were really, really helpful in getting that done. Something else that needs to happen if you're working on AWS commercial is FIPS is not on by default in things. You have to call AWS support and say, please turn on FIPS for this AWS account for load balancers. They're not magically there. Or when you test, it fails and you have to find out and you have to do it again. So we were maniacally sending lists and spreadsheets to AWS. Please turn on FIPS on all these AWS accounts for us. So there's some legwork you may have to do there that you won't know unless you're doing it there. And most importantly, it's FedRAMP is a team sport. We've collaborated with AWS, within our compliance teams, with our internal and external auditors, with our legal, compliance, everybody. And I'm incredibly thankful for that team for making this all happen, because it was a couple dozen people, hundreds of people working to get it done. So what's next? I can't wait for that email to show up in my mailbox saying, yes, you're authorized. Sales cannot wait either, because then they can sell. I don't need to say that, but, right? But being FedRAMP authorized is just one step. If you're familiar with FedRAMP, you have to be continuously authorized over and over and over. You have to report every month vulnerabilities, do continuous monitoring, and all that stuff. So FedRAMP never ends, essentially. You're forever doing it if you want to continue selling in this market. And of course, our products change. Right, developer decides to bring a new third party tomorrow. Guess what? That third party is not authorized. You're in trouble. So you have to handle change management. There's different levels of complexity on that change management. And if it's a big change management, you can't do it until you get to a certain audit point or something. So those are tricky, and you have to keep working in that team to understand those. And then I'm sure the business is going to say, now that you're FedRAMP, I want all these other products and services, they fall into this change management category. I can't bring a new product in unless we have a very, very concerted effort to do that. And of course, the business is going to say, hey, now that you got to FedRAMP moderate, I want high. Right? That's what the business, that the business doesn't know how complicated it is. And maybe they do. Maybe we'll get to FedRAMP high. Maybe we'll need GovCloud. But now we have a playbook. We know how to do it. We can do it again. All right. And then for anyone who knows FedRAMP, revision 5 is coming. I don't actually know the details. I just know we're working on it. I see the Jira user stories. Revision 5 is coming. We have to be ready for it for next year. So like I said, it never ends. Right? So if, once you're in it, it never ends. All right. And with that, I want to thank you for your time. Thank you for talking government with me today. This is the last session of the expo, so enjoy your coffee, enjoy your drinks at 6 o'clock tonight. And I'll be here if you want to talk and connect. Thank you.